First off, Jesus loves those who are sick. Jesus loves the sick. And then our second week together, we looked at the fact that Jesus is with us in our suffering. He does not leave us to go through these things on our own. And then we looked at the great enemy death last time, and we saw that Jesus confronted death, and he was victorious over death. But today, maybe the most sober of all of the messages in this chapter, we're going to look at the theme of spiritual heart disease. I would say to you, church, that the most dangerous illness, the most crippling and debilitating malady, the most bitter and painful condition, the greatest sickness of all any of us will face in our lives, and every one of us have this battle without Christ, is that of spiritual heart disease. On the screen, there's a verse that some of you have heard. If you've grown up in the church, you've been around the church, Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9. This is what the prophet says. He says, "The heart is deceitful, and it is desperately sick. It is desperately wicked. Who can know it?" Now, that's a pretty tough passage to start a message out with, but it's very true. The heart is deceitful. We can be deceived. We can deceive ourselves. It is desperately wicked. It's not neutral. It's not amoral. The heart always has chosen the wrong side on its own. And then it says it's sick. It is full of corruption. Now, we need to understand something here very quickly, because some of you have physical heart problems. When the Bible talks about the heart, it is not talking about the heart as a vital organ that pumps blood throughout the body to sustain us and keep us alive. When it talks about the heart, which it mentions over 300 times, it is speaking of the very core of our being. It is speaking about the innermost person inside of us, the spiritual part of us where our emotions and our desires all dwell. You see, we are not a body. We are a soul. We have a body, as C.S. Lewis said. And the heart is our innermost person. And so, when I talk about spiritual heart disease, usually we think of cardiovascular disease when we think of the heart, don't we? And we think of the fact that this refers to a lot of symptoms that we can struggle with, and it speaks of the narrowing or blocked blood vessels that lead to a heart attack, a chest pain, or stroke. There are symptoms of heart disease that lead to the danger of having one of these terrible things happen to us. And today, I want you to see on this next passage on the screen from Mark chapter 7 that there are symptoms of spiritual heart disease. We're going to see them in our text today, but I want you to hear what Jesus says about them in Mark 7. Jesus says, "From within and out of the heart of man come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, they come out, and they defile a person." Now, what Jesus is saying here is the heart of the matter is your heart. These are all symptoms of an inner problem. So if you have evil thoughts, that comes from a heart that is sick. If you slander, it comes from a heart that is hard. If you are foolish, it comes from a heart that is disobedient. Chest pains is symptomatic of cardiovascular disease. These things are symptomatic of spiritual heart disease. Now, there's a warning before we read John 11 today, and this is it. Many of us have been conditioned as Americans or even as Christians in this nation to use the expression, we are conditioned to sweep everything under the rug in our lives. We don't like confrontation. We don't like painful surgery that might correct the problem. So what we do is we constantly sweep our sins under the proverbial rug. We try to hide something damaging or unpleasant, and we try to keep it secret. But here's the thing. If you continually sweep things under the rug, eventually you're not going to be able to walk on the rug, correct? Eventually, you're going to run out of room, and it's going to start to pop out. A great example of this is either children or churches. So I'll use both. Children, like to be told to clean the room, and what they like to do is take all of their belongings and do what with them very quickly to appease their parents? Under the bed or in the what? In the closet, right? Now, it's kind of interesting that children and churches have so much in common, because we have an education building behind us, and whoever designed that wonderful building designed it with zero closets in it. There's two utility closets, no actual closet space. And so guess what everyone does when they have something that's been donated to the church that no one wants, or they have something and it doesn't belong in a classroom anymore, where do you think they put it? They throw it in one of the utility closets. They're not even supposed to contain anything. And it wasn't long ago, I actually went into one of the utility closets in the youth room, and I opened the thing up, and it was like an avalanche came out, you know? Pretty amazing. And then I made a couple trips to the dumpster. So what I want to say to you is, you can only hide things so long, but the symptoms, these evil things that are inside of us, are eventually going to come out if we have spiritual heart disease. They're going to be seen. You can't hide them forever. And so Jesus today, as we look at John 11, is going to show us in his word some of the people that very much reflect spiritual heart disease. And I hope today that we will realize that while it's not always easy to have surgery, all right, sometimes it takes work to carry all that stuff out to the dumpster to get rid of it. When you go under with heart surgery, it hurts. You can't cough without hurting, right? You can't move without hurting. Some of you have had that. You have a triple bypass. You're going to be in pain for a while, but when you're done the surgery and a month later, you thank God for that doctor, because without the surgery, you would have died. And now you can breathe and you can walk and you can live again. See, sometimes it's painful to have this surgery, but brothers and sisters, it is absolutely what we need. So here with me, John 11. Lazarus has risen from the grave. Many have believed on Jesus because of this mighty miracle. Death and sickness have been defeated that day. And then look where John takes us, beginning at verse 47. We'll start at verse 45 for context. Then many of the Jews who had come to Mary and had seen the things Jesus did believed in him. But some of them went away to the Pharisees and told them the things Jesus did. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered a council, and they said, "What shall we do? For this man works many signs. If we let him alone like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." And one of them, Caiaphas, being high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all. Nor do you consider that it is expedient for us that one man should die for the people, and not that the whole nation should perish." But this he did not say on his own authority. But being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for that nation only, but also that he would gather together in one the children of God who were scattered abroad. Then from that day on, they plotted to put Jesus to death. Therefore, Jesus no longer walked openly among the Jews, but went from there into the country near the wilderness, to a city called Ephraim, and there he remained with his disciples. And the Passover of the Jews was near, and many went from the country up to Jerusalem before the Passover. Notice, they went to purify themselves. Then they sought Jesus and stood among themselves as they stood in the temple. They said, "What do you think? That he will not come to the feast?" Now both the chief priests and the Pharisees had given a command that if anyone knew where he was, he should report it, that they might seize Jesus. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, we come now. Please still us. Lord, please calm our hearts. Lord, we need to consider our symptoms, but also we need to consider, most importantly, what we need to have a healthy heart, to have a heart that's right with you. Lord, we've just read some words of anger and hatred, bitterness, murderous thoughts. And Lord, that is the common condition of man without the love of Christ. And so today I pray that your love would win, that today you would bring victory, today you would bring healing, that you would come to the brokenhearted, and you would put that heart that is shattered back together again and make it stronger and healthier than it ever was, that you would redeem Oh, Lord, help us, we ask, because we cannot do this on our own. We need you, the surgeon. We need the Holy Spirit, the comforter. So we pray these things together in Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen. Lazarus has risen from the dead. The popularity of Jesus is spreading all throughout the capital of Jerusalem, just 2 miles away from the city of Bethany where this great miracle was worked. Many have believed on Christ. They've come to Jesus. They've been rescued by Jesus. And now some of them rejected Jesus and chose to go, you notice, in verses 47 and 48 to the religious leaders. So we see first in this passage the problem. They go to the chief priests and to the Pharisees. Now let me tell you a little bit about these two groups. These two groups are warring parties in Israel. They're the religious leaders of Israel, and quite ironically, the religious people don't like each other. The chief priests are members of the Sadducee party. The Sadducees were the wealthy party of Israel, mainly people in the upper echelon of the financial world. These were people who only held to the first 5 books of the Old Testament as the Word of God, and they rejected the idea of a resurrection, that one day God would resurrect bodies and they would go and go to heaven to be with the Lord, with the soul that's been there, and then the new heavens and the new earth. They rejected the idea of the afterlife and the resurrection. And then you have the Pharisees, who are the very opposite of the Sadducees. Most of the Pharisees were of the lower financial sector of Israel. And they actually believed in the entire Old Testament, that it was all the Word of God. And they did believe in the resurrection. Now, all of a sudden, we've got these two groups who diametrically are opposed in their beliefs, opposed in their lifestyles, all of a sudden coming together. And enemies are coming together in opposition against the truth. It's very interesting that even the people that hate one another will unite together when it comes to opposing God and His goodness. We should never be surprised if we see this in the world. We should never feel like this is some shock. I remember what the great preacher of Scotland, John Knox, said. He said, "One man with God is always in the majority." There are times when you're going to feel outnumbered because the enemies are going to surround you. And you haven't even done anything to them. But you must recognize here, this is exactly what happened to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The religious people are the greatest enemies to the gospel here. So they come together into a council, the New King James says. This is the Greek word Sanhedrin. This was the highest Jewish ruling body. 71 members of this body, they were the main legislators. They were the main religious body in the nation under the Roman leadership. And you notice they come together and they begin to discuss Jesus and this great miracle of the raising of Lazarus. In fact, they say, "This man is working many signs." Notice they do not deny the power of God in Jesus' life. They do not deny the miracles. They do not deny the signs that Jesus has done. You can't deny when God works. But what you can do is you can twist it. You can take the glory from God. You can give the glory to the wrong person. And you see here, they begin to attack Jesus and they say, "What shall we do? What are we accomplishing? If we leave Jesus alone like this, the Romans are going to come, they're going to take away our place, they're going to take away our nation." In other words, they're not really concerned about what's right and what's wrong. They're not concerned about truth and error. They're concerned about two things. Number one, our place. Some people think this refers to the temple. Some people think it refers to their position as the leaders of Israel. The Romans are going to come. If everyone starts following Jesus, the Romans might get nervous that we're going to have an uprising, and the Romans will come and they're going to squash us. They're going to come with all of their might, and they're going to take away our leadership, and they'll even take away our nation. So they're talking about their own personal possessions, finances, abilities, worship, and they're also talking about patriotism. They act as if they're so concerned about their country. So this is so ironic, isn't it? That they're worried that Jesus is going to mount up some army that's going to overthrow them, and then the Romans will come and take away their money and their nation. You know, you have to ask yourself sometimes, do the enemies of truth ever listen to the truth? Because did Jesus ever talk about amassing an army that by force was going to come into Jerusalem and take over? Jesus said this, listen to this. If you have this idea that there's some sort of a Christian right, some Christian moral majority that's going to march into Washington, D.C. and take it over, you've got to understand, Jesus said, my kingdom, this is his sermon, Luke 17, my kingdom is not of this world. Jesus said, render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and unto God the things that are God's. Now, I want you to hear this because it's very important that you don't mistake what I'm saying here. Christians should love their country. They should care about their country. They should do everything in their power to see truth, justice, righteousness be the ruling law of the land. Which means we always pray and we vote for the best politicians that reflect this. We try to not only uphold good laws, but we stand strong in support of leaders that do this. And we voice loudly when there is sin and error and wickedness. We know righteousness exalts a nation and sin is a reproach to a people. But Jesus never called on us to have the Christian party. He called on us to be Christians first, which will then influence the parties. You understand what I'm saying? In other words, we should not say we're going to take Washington, D.C. back or we're going to take Jerusalem back. We should say this, I am going to be a Christian. I'm going to be salt and light of the world. And when the light shines in the darkness, it's going to defeat the darkness. We believe that. But what we don't want to do is so get entangled in the political system that all of a sudden people don't hate us because we're of light and we're of Jesus and we're love. People hate us because our hands have gotten dirty in politics. Now, Christians can be in politics and should be and should make a difference. But this is what the Pharisees, their very heart is all they care about is physical buildings and projects and nation and finances. And I want to say to you, who cares about any of that if the enemy has your family? Who cares who's president if your kids don't know Jesus? Who cares who the governor is if your family is disintegrating tomorrow, right? My kingdom is not of this world, Jesus said. These religious leaders didn't care about the love of Jesus, the gospel. All they were focused on was politics and finances. And so they messed it up terribly. And I want to say to you, Jesus said this in Matthew 6. He said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You want to know what happened to these leaders? Because they rejected Jesus, they didn't put the gospel first, the love of God first, the forgiveness and salvation that God offers first. One day their nation did get struck in AD 70, and the temple was destroyed, and the Romans took them away. I say to you, the best thing we can do for our nation is be the people God has called us to be light and love in brokenness. Yes, we should care about the nation, but first and foremost, we need to care about our families and our church and our community. Amen? This is what God has called us to. Now, here, I want you to notice very clearly, they are worried about a nation. Now, here's the thing. The Bible is clear. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1 on the screen. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even the things that are not, to bring to nothing the things that are. Jesus wasn't creating an army of the powerful elites to take over Jerusalem. Jesus was raising up the weak and the hurting to be the people God had called them to be. Look at the next passage in Luke 1, verses 51 to 53. When Jesus is about to be born, Mary sings this song. And what a beautiful song it is to our God. She says that the Lord has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones, and he has exalted those of humble estate. The hungry he has filled with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. These people were so concerned simply about their nation, simply about their jobs and their possessions, they forgot what matters most. Let me just say something to you, brothers and sisters. On your deathbed, you will not say, oh, that I had worked an extra 10 hours every week. You will not say, oh, on your deathbed, you're not going to say, oh, that George Bush and Barack Obama and Donald Trump were the president. Why, oh, why? You're not going to talk about CNN or Fox News on your deathbed. You know what you're going to think about? Your children. Why didn't I pray with them more? My family. Why didn't I reach out to them more? My neighbor. Why didn't I love them more? Why didn't I share the gospel more? Why didn't I pray more? I want to say to you, if you get the order right, the other stuff works out. Amen. They had the order wrong. And that's why they want to crucify Jesus. Their hearts are full of all the wrong things. Now, we're going to continue on. Look at verses 49 to 52. We've seen the problem. Now look at the prophecy. One of them, Caiaphas, being high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you consider it is expedient for us that one man should die for the people and not that the whole nation should perish." Now this he did not say on his own authority, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation. And not for that nation also, but that he would gather together in one the children of God who were scattered abroad. So this council, they're arguing, they're kind of lost amongst each other. And then all of a sudden, Caiaphas walks in. History tells us his name was Joseph Caiaphas. He was the high priest of Israel. He had been made the high priest in the year AD 18. And we are told here in history that he was a Sadducee, meaning he didn't believe in the resurrection. Now, what was the miracle that just had happened? Lazarus had just been what? Rose from the grave. Which kind of proves he's wrong, right? And now all of a sudden, people aren't following him. They're following this poor man from Galilee named Jesus who's showing love and doing miracles. And we see the fruit of this highly educated, intelligent, and ruthless man here as he walks into the council and he says, "You all don't know nothing at all. You don't know what you're talking about." This is a statement of contempt against his colleagues, a hateful statement. What did we read in Mark 7? Out of the heart comes what? Symptoms of the condition of the heart. And some of the things that come out of the heart of man are evil thoughts and coveting and sensuality and slander and foolishness. And these things come out. This guy's heart isn't right as he comes in and starts to, he's not trying to make friends here. He's belittling and demeaning everybody. By the way, that is not how Christ followers should talk and act. Now, he comes in there and then he begins to callously suggest that we should execute an innocent person, and that's okay if it secures an advantage for the nation. Think about this. He's a wretched politician, and he would rather kill someone innocently than lose his job. He would rather do something unjust and unrighteous in a corrupt way than say, "What would God have us to do?" Shouldn't they have been God? If they didn't really know if Jesus was God or not, don't you think they should have stopped and prayed? Isn't that what religious people are supposed to do? Instead of coming in, assaulting one another, and just trying to kill someone. Look, if your first response in the time of conflict is to cut people out of your life and to judge people and to hurt people, something's wrong with your heart. Something's wrong with your heart. Now, immediately here, he wants to kill Christ. Proverbs 17:15, look at it on the screen. It says there, "He who justifies the wicked and he who condemns the righteous are both alike an abomination to the Lord." He would kill an innocent man and not think twice about it. How cold, calculating, self-sufficient, shrewd, self-satisfied this man really is. This shows us how desperately wicked a man's heart is. Think about this. He could have walked 2 miles to Bethany and seen Lazarus alive. He has heard of the great miracles Jesus has done. A man has been raised to life. Even his fellow Sanhedrin members say this man has worked many signs, and yet he shuts his eyes to overwhelming evidence. He refuses to be convinced. Brothers and sisters, this is the power of unbelief. This is the power of a sick heart. It refuses to see what is right in front of it. We need to understand something. We need to understand that it takes the love of Christ and the comfort of the Holy Spirit to change a heart. We can't do this on our own. You can't beat someone into Christianity. You can't argue someone into the faith. You can't twist their arm and make them believe on Jesus and love Jesus. This is the work of God. When Jesus was asked, "Who can be saved?" He said, "With men it is impossible, but with God all things are possible." I'm trusting God we're going to have a lot of baptisms on Easter. Why? Because with God, all things are possible. Amen. I believe that people are going to follow Jesus. They're going to give their lives to him. We've already got two that want to do it. And I'm trusting that God's going to do it in many more because he's a saving God. not because of how great our church is or how our intellectual arguments are of who Jesus is or how good the coffee is in the foyer, though it's pretty good. Thank you, Sister Heather. It's pretty good. But that's not what's going to lead anyone to Jesus, right? It's going to be the Holy Spirit. So what does he say here? He prophesies and he says, one man should die for the people. This is a false either-or situation. Either Jesus dies or the nation goes. Really, is God that little that we can put him in this little box and say it's either this or that and there's no other options? My God holds the world in his hand and you're going to limit God to either A or B? There's 22 letters in the alphabet, right? At least go to Z, amen? God can do what he wants to do. Who are you to limit God? Now, Calvin says here these words. I've got the quote on the screen. They double their wickedness by a plausible disguise, their zeal for the public good. They pretend to be anxious about the temple and the worship of God. That's what religious people do. They cloak their unbelief and their hardness of heart in some sort of a fake spirituality, some fake excuse. Oh, but the church. Oh, but you know this is the right thing to do because people are watching. Look, God is watching, and it's a little more important than what people are watching. God is watching. What does God want from us is what we should ask. Now, I love this here because in verses 51 and 52, John gives us kind of a parenthetical thought, and he says this was a prophecy that was being given. Now, Caiaphas was an unwilling prophet here. I love how God providentially, sovereignly can work in our evil hearts. He can even use an evil man. Think about how in the Old Testament, God used a donkey, right? He used Balaam, and he used the donkey to prophesy to Balaam. And then he raised up a wicked man named Balaam and uses him to prophesy blessing over the people of Israel. Look, our God is sovereign, and he will do what he pleases. And he can even use the wicked. So, some of you, the last 8 years, you were all upset because of who the president was. I was praying for the president. Some of you are upset right now who the president is. I'm praying for the president. You know why? Because God can use who he will use for his glory. And because we're commanded to do it, by the way. That's another good reason. Now, we have to understand here, he didn't know what he was saying. He just wants Jesus to die for the nation. What he doesn't realize is Jesus is going to be the scapegoat for the nation. But he's not going to die for them just so they can have a lot of money and have a successful infrastructure and that they can have a good tax system and that their coffers can get full in the temple. He's going to die to take away the sins of the world. Notice it's not just for this nation, but it's for all the peoples of the world. The church father, Chrysostom, says, Caiaphas here prophesied, not knowing what he said. The grace of God merely made use of his mouth, but it did not touch his accursed heart. So here he begins to prophesy the church. Look, I want you to understand something today. If you don't get anything else, I want you to hear something. Jesus loves the lost. Jesus came to take those who are scattered and who are hurting and alone, whose hearts are broken, who are following all the wrong things and going in the wrong direction, and he came to turn them around and get them going in the right direction. He came to take a shattered heart, and he's not just going to glue it back together and it's going to be this messy mumbo-jumbo of a heart. No, he's going to give you a new heart. He's not just going to say, I forgive you for now. He's going to say, you are forgiven. It is finished. He's not going to just come to you and just accept you for a little while until you mess up again. Look, God knows how many more times you're going to mess up in your life. He didn't save you because you're pretty. He saved you because you're messy and he loves you in spite of it. Because Jesus is going to take your messiness on himself when he dies on the cross. Now look how this section closes out. Verses 53 to 57. We've seen the problem. We've seen the prophecy. Now look at the plot. Then from that day on, they plotted to put him to death. Therefore, Jesus no longer walked openly among the Jews, but he went from there into the country near the wilderness to a city called Ephraim, and there he remained with his disciples. The Passover of the Jews was near. Many went from the country up to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. Then they sought Jesus. They spoke among themselves as they stood in the temple. What do you think, that he will not come to the feast? Now both the chief priests and the Pharisees had given a command that if anyone knew where he was, he should report it that they might seize him. We've seen the problem. We've seen the prophecy. Look at the plot as we wrap this up. They were plotting. They were resolved in verse 53. I want you to see the power of evil words coming from a broken heart. One man, just listen to this. One man's lying, slander, led 70 other men into sin. One man's deceit and pride, sick heart, led a whole nation into sin. Do you see this here? One man. They weren't going to kill Jesus before, but one man's lying deceit. Listen, the power of words is amazing. They can build up or they can destroy. And here we see it so clearly. This one man, Caiaphas, boldly, outspokenly speaking from a sick heart, carried the council with him. Now we know Nicodemus was a Pharisee and he was a follower of Jesus. We know Joseph of Arimathea was a Pharisee and a follower of Jesus. We know that Gamaliel, we read about him in the New Testament. We don't know if he ever followed Jesus, but he was a very wise and godly man, at least up to this point. And yet, even if those three men spoke out, one man's slanderous, hateful words caused pain to a nation, caused 70 others to consent to the death of Jesus. The power of one liar, of one evil speech coming from a broken heart became the official position. That Jesus became the supreme outlaw of history, the man who loved like no one else, who healed like no one else, who cared like no one else, who fed the hungry, who comforted the sick, who rescued the broken, is now the supreme outlaw of the nation because of one man's lies and pride and slander. Do you see how dangerous spiritual heart disease is? One lie can break a family. One lie can ruin a politician. One lie can destroy a church. One lie can wreck your life. Oh, that we would be wise about this. Look at these verses on the screen. Proverbs 18, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. A good heart speaks truth and love and grace and builds up. A heart that is sick speaks lies and slander and deceit and tears down and kills. Look at Proverbs 16:28 on the bottom. A dishonest man spreads strife, and a whisperer will separate the closest of friends. How about this? A whisperer like Caiaphas will separate a nation from her God. How sad this is. The irony is, if they had humbled themselves, if they had turned from their sin, if they had received Jesus and believed his gospel, Jerusalem might still have been standing to this day like it was in Solomon's day. It might have been mighty and flourishing and had shalom and peace. Today, Jerusalem still is a city of conflict because they rejected Christ, and it is not until the Prince of Peace steps foot in that city again that they will have perfect peace. But oh, if they had believed on him that day, if their hearts had been healed, what could have come of it? You notice in verse 54, Jesus no longer walked openly. Jesus' enemies could not force him to the cross. He was going to lay his life down, right? But he would no longer walk openly. It was not his time to die yet. And so, brothers and sisters, I want you to notice there's a lesson here. It's worth noticing that our Lord chose a scene of quiet and seclusion as his last dwelling place before going up to the crucifixion. Sometimes, when God is at work in our hearts and we've been hurt, we need to just get away. We need to be still and know that he is God. Sometimes, God uses these things, these pain, these lying, hateful things, to do great things in our lives, in our families, in our church, but only if we will go away and we will be still, and we will say, God, what are you doing? Jesus could have came with vengeance on these leaders. He could have called down a legion of angels to deal with these corrupt men. He could have called justice on them. But what does he do? He goes away to hear from God, his Father, to listen, to rest, to prepare for the next season, the next step. Some of you in this room need to get alone with God. The reason why you haven't learned from the pain is because you're not drawing to God. In your pain and suffering and in the brokenness, he wants us to put our eyes not on the pain, not on the suffering, not on the brokenness. He wants to put our eyes on him. And if that means deleting your Facebook account, if that means turning the television off, if that means stop listening to talk radio and focus on the things that matter most, you better do it, brothers and sisters. Because you can't keep doing what you're doing and expect a different result. If our Lord had to get away to hear from the Father, who do you think you are that you don't have to? Now this ends. I want you to notice in verse 55, Passover has started. We're going to get into Passover when we begin the next series in John 12. But Passover has started. And so the people are coming up. You notice they come up to purify themselves. I want you to see the last condition that we find here of a spiritual heart disease. There's a lot of people that do this. They sweep their sin and their sickness under the rug, proverbially, but they never purify their heart. They look good on the outside. They're plastic people, and they look perfect on Sunday morning. They have a perfect smile when they walk in the doors. They were cursing in the car in the parking lot. And someone says, "How are you doing?" "My week was wonderful." You're plastic. It wasn't wonderful. It was terrible. And if it wasn't for the faithfulness of God, I wouldn't be standing here today. That would be a little more honest, right? Now think about this. Outwardly they go and they put a show on and they wash and they fast. And yet in a few days later, they're going to shed innocent blood. And they're going to kill Jesus. Isn't that amazing? Again, I want to say to you, it's often religious people that need to get saved. There are people in every church who have been attending for years. And they need to get saved. They've never been forgiven of their sins. Look, I don't care how many times you've been baptized, how many times you've shook a pastor's hand. I don't care how much money you give. For from within and out of the heart comes all of these bad symptoms. You need a new heart. You need Jesus in your heart. You need to receive him. This is what he said in the Beatitudes, his first sermon. As he began it, he wanted to make this so clear. Look what he said in Matthew 5. "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God." Not blessed are the rich. Not blessed are the church members. Not blessed are the baptized. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. The resurrection of Lazarus, the sickness, the death, the resurrection of Lazarus, just like all of Jesus' life and ministry, calls us to decision today. Some people believed on Jesus. They had faith in Jesus and their lives were changed forever. Some people were indifferent and their hearts were not forgiven. And some were hostile to God and their sins were heavy on them. I read an article from the New York Times. I looked it up for this message. I was trying to find out what a new heart would cost a person. According to the New York Times, May 16, 2010, a new heart costs $864,700 to procure, get a transplant, and maintain the heart with the proper medication. $864,700, almost $1 million to get a new heart and have a heart transplant and keep it going. Isn't that amazing? I want to say to you, the most lasting heart transplant you will ever get is when you turn to Jesus Christ. And it costs more than $1 million. It costs the blood of Jesus. And he died and took the punishment for our sins. And then he was risen from the grave. And the Bible says, whoever believes on him will have everlasting life. The Bible says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and you believe where? In your heart, that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Wouldn't it be great if someone got saved today? If someone's heart got set free this day from bondage and bitterness and brokenness and sinfulness and evil thoughts and adultery and murder and whatever else is inside of you. We've all struggled with these sins, but wouldn't it be great if Jesus just gave you a new heart today and set you free? All that we would bow to him right now in prayer and you would call out to him. Let's pray together. If you don't...
Friend, this is Joshua Wallnofer, pastor of Klondike Baptist, and I want to thank you for taking the time to listen to this sermon today. If we can be of any help to you, answer any questions about the Bible, or talk more with you about the salvation provided by the mighty hand of Christ Jesus, feel free to contact us by any of the methods mentioned on our church website. If you would like to share a testimony of how God's Word has transformed your life, please write and let us know. We'd love to hear from you. And remember, Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall anyone pluck them out of my hand."